Yeah, we on Boss Talk 101. Yeah, we gon' talk, we gon' have fun. We be on fire, we be lit lit. It's a unique hustle, big shit. Big shit,
big shit,
big shit. It's a unique hustle, nigga, big shit. Big shit,
big shit,
big shit. Name another podcast like this.
Check it, check it, check it. It's a unique hustle. It's your boy ECEO, and I'm here with the lovely, amazing, fantastic. Yeah, Miss Jamaica, what's going on?
Hey man,
another day. God done made another way. Yeah, I got something. Don't talk about no dollar. We don't need no money. We got God. Check it, man. We got a brother here today, man. He really don't need no introduction, man. He been ripping through the internet. Niggas is really a lot of niggas that been doing it longer than he has is kind of upset. The nigga done just came on the scene and he really butt naked out here. That mean he ain't trying to hold no punches back, man. Check it, my guy Chris Sko is in the building. What's going on?
What's good, bro? What's good, man? Just say no to Sko. We in the building, man. What's good, fam?
Hey, it's so good to have you on the show, man.
Nigga, I've been waiting on my call, nigga.
Hey,
I seen a few niggas you had up around the hold on, nigga. I'm stepping on that nigga. I was sizing niggas up.
I'm gonna be honest with you. This is organically done.
Yeah.
So when we do it, it be from a different place. It be from the heart. You know what I'm saying? Most of these niggas do it for clout.
Yeah.
But we do it from the heart. So when we link with people, like I said, my brother told me about you.
Yeah.
And my brother you ain't never seen him, probably ain't gonna see him.
Yeah.
But when he tell me this is who I need to do or what, and I'm gonna move on it.
A nigga in the bushes, he watching.
Yeah, so he tell my son, 28, he in Kansas right now. He was in you this morning, but he ain't even in the state.
Yeah.
But he just basically trying to pull it together. He hit my wife up and we start rolling. I said, okay, I hit the nigga up. So that's how, and then you start getting them hits.
Yeah, and what's up, man?
And thank you for responding.
I'm a fan, nigga. I watched the show. Run some of your content. I most definitely went over the shit you talking about.
Wow.
OG Bobby Billions, Rain, Water, different things you talked about.
Yeah, Charleston White,
all that shit.
Yeah, man, been a host of them. DeRoe, everybody been through here, man. We done got up to almost 400 episodes in 10 months. We drop every damn day, nigga.
Nah, y'all working,
yeah,
fam.
I don't see nobody else really doing it like that, bro.
My nigga, you got niggas looking lazy out here, bro.
Period. And I was happy when I came in the game. I was like, oh, this what they doing?
Yeah.
They just dropping, they just dropping what, once a week, twice a week. I got these niggas.
Dallas needs this, though. The city needs this.
Thank you, man.
City needs this.
They need you, too. You know what I'm saying?
Our styles are different, though. See, let me show you how I do this shit out here.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all, people who do interviews and, you know, a lot of time to do and do content all day, I will let y'all drop, and then that night, we the talk show.
I seen that.
We the late night hour. We gonna break down what everybody else talking about.
Yeah.
I'm the Black Geraldo, nigga.
I love it.
I'm the Dallas Geraldo. We're going to get some shit started.
Nigga, I'm Phil Donahue, nigga. Don't try to leave me.
I'm the Black Geraldo, nigga.
We coming on, but I'm just doing mine during the day.
Yeah.
And you doing yours during the night,
we starting shit during the night, bro. Yeah, you know how we going to do it, man.
I knew she was going to do that.
I got to find out first, where did the name Crisco come from? Because when I think about Crisco, I'm thinking about the oil degree, all of that.
You know what? My name used to be Chris Style. I was rapping, just a young nigga, you know, coming straight out of Garland. You know, I'm an East Garland nigga.
East Garland in the building. Yeah, Dairy, nigga. Stop playing, nigga.
Yeah, nigga, First Street,
stop
all that
playing.
Shit. Nigga.
First Street, Miller, nigga. Stop playing.
And really all through Garland, nigga. The whole G, all through Garland.
Broadway. Yeah, all that. Going all back up. Where was he at? Jupiter, nigga. Walnut. Yeah, I might back up on that. Yeah, I see you, nigga.
Yeah, I mean, so salute to the whole G, man. I was just a nigga named Chris Style. Then I started seeing that name get taken. It was a DJ named DJ Chris Style and some old shit. So I just came up with Sko. You know what I mean? And me and my nigga just started kind of calling me Chris. My name is Chris. You know what I'm talking about? So niggas started calling me. I was looking for something else to go with that damn Chris. And it was Sko. You know what I'm talking about?
So
Chris Sko. Yeah, I turned myself because that nigga, me and Bosco 100, we had an argument on my show not too long ago. That nigga said he was Sko before me, but the nigga a damn lie. I've been Sko since 06.
Wow.
You feel me? So yeah, Bosco see this nigga, you a damn lie. I've been Sko long before Bosco 100 was Bosco, my nigga.
Already. Yeah. So just give us a little bit of a rundown. How was it growing up over on First Street and Derry and all that?
Are you an only child?
No, I got a brother. I'm the youngest child.
You're the youngest.
Yeah, I'm the youngest child.
So
I got an older
mama's
brother.
Boy.
Nah, I wasn't a mama's boy, but I'm the youngest. We're gonna say that. You know what I'm talking about? I wasn't a mama's boy, but I'm the youngest.
Okay.
Yeah, I grew up in Garland. I'm talking about straight Garland. Born in Baylor, went home straight to 16 Curtis Street.
Street. Yeah. Boy, you got me thinking, boy.
Yeah, man.
I used to be over there, bro.
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about? All over there, man.
I love it.
Yeah, so I grew up in Sweet Home Missionary Baptist Church.
Already.
Mm. You know, went to all the Garland schools. Salute to all my Checkahoe niggas, them A1 niggas, what? All them tight white
Checkahoe,
niggas.
Checkahoe, that yeah. nigga, boy, yeah. you don't even know I got my partner named Checkahoe. Yeah, yeah, yeah man, so, I ain't even going to go there, man. Yeah, I man, got
salute
excited.
To the G,
boy,
man.
I had to tell y'all the field, yeah. nigga. I know about that
hey,
Checkahoe.
Salute to all my, yes, from Rose Gate to East Gate to New West to goddamn East Centerville Point.
That boy
to,
talking, man.
Yeah,
you know, yeah, he
real,
up there
yeah, real Garland nigga.
By Wooden Meadow and all that, just on that shit. Side of the bridge.
Ooh.
Yeah, nigga,
ooh.
Stop playing, nigga. I know.
Yeah,
man, come on, man.
Say, look, but niggas don't know that. You just go under that bridge, boom, you right there on Ferguson. You on that phone
already,
block.
Already know. Yeah. That's exactly
yeah.
what you had.
I sold my first piece of dope over there as a young
man. Hey, man.
I went underneath that bridge.
By yourself.
You know what I mean? I went underneath that bridge.
New Island right there back in the yeah. day. Stop yeah. playing, man. Aspen yeah. Chase, man, you was over there on Wood Meadow,
Honey Creek,
Honey Creek.
Yeah, all
you
that,
all
man.
Through there,
all up and down the floor, man. Yeah,
man, what, boy, it was some killings over there at that store. It
yeah,
was just
bro.
One of my little partners got killed over there about 2 or 3 years ago. But let's go back into your like childhood. So, she gonna want to stay right there for
yeah.
a minute.
So was your dad in the picture during all this time?
Nah, I never met my dad to this day. No
never.
Pops. No pops.
So, do you know who your father is?
I think I know who this nigga is, and it's crazy because I think I seen the nigga's son on Facebook or something like that. You know what I'm talking about? And the nigga name was Junior of what my
so
daddy's name
on,
was.
Hold on, let's go.
Yeah.
So your mom never told you who your dad was? Or
she told me who he was, but she didn't talk about the nigga like that at all. Remember, we talking about the 80s. We talking about,
right.
you know, nigga, I mean, my mom got, you know, 3 kids by 3 different niggas.
Yeah,
I'm
yeah, yeah,
she only
yeah.
got 3 kids.
No, that's
okay.
it.
You know what I mean? So that's how it was with a
when
lot of people growing up
was.
In the 80s.
Yeah,
when
right.
no, look, when nobody daddy around. Me not having a daddy growing up didn't mean shit to me back then because guess what? I had 10 cousins around me. They damn daddy wasn't there either.
Oh, really?
Nobody daddy was my brother daddy, my sister daddy. So I didn't look at it like, oh, man, I'm this shit sad. Nah, it was life to us.
Lifestyle.
Like, ain't nobody dropping up no Pampers, no milk, no nothing around this motherfucker.
Dope.
But as you got older, though, and look back on your life, having your father being absent in your life,
yeah.
do you think that, you know, affected your life somehow?
Most definitely.
How?
I'm going to say just them years, you know, spending the main years is going to be like between 15 and 25. You know
mm-hmm.
what I mean? Them years where you turning from a boy to a man. Oh, you need a nigga that love you. See, it's one thing people think about, you know, OGs and this and that. Nah, it's nothing like a nigga that love you to tell you something.
No, mm-hmm. real talk.
You know what I mean? So when you grow up and you got friends, because one of my best friends growing up, that nigga dad was there. You know, my best friend, his dad
okay.
was always in his life.
So
you
did see that, because I know
yeah.
when you said, well, my cousins didn't have a dad or this person didn't have a dad. So you did have somebody
yeah.
in your life who had a father.
Right,
so you looked
right.
at that.
Right. And
okay.
that was, and I'm gonna be honest with y'all, when I first went to his crib to spend the night in my homeboy house and I seen his daddy there, that shit was like I thought I seen an alien.
Wow.
A grown black man walking around the house, you know what I mean? Like handling business. And it was, you know, it was crazy. You know what I mean? And plus they hit him, they married and all their kids by one man.
Wow.
So to me, that was like, what? Like, y'all all got the same daddy.
Like, that's possible.
Yeah, y'all got the same daddy and shit. Your mom and daddy married. Like, y'all still together? Y'all got a house? We didn't see that shit right or wrong, nigga. We didn't see that kind of shit growing up. That
wow.
was, to me, that was something new. So yeah, growing up, like I said, in them 80s, every nigga from my era know what I'm talking about.
Damn,
I mean,
right.
Nobody
yes,
had a
sir.
Dad around.
Yes,
it was like, and it wasn't nothing. It wasn't
but
even
got,
no big deal.
Do you ever feel like you say you think you know who he is.
Yeah.
Do you ever feel like you want to reach out to him to say, hey, I'm
Man.
His son?
I kind of reached out to his son. You,
you
know
did?
What I mean? I reached out to his son and his son, you know, his son told me straight up, nigga, my pops say they don't know you or your mama, nigga.
Mm.
Wow.
But it was weird, though. This is the weird
but
part about it.
But he could be lying,
Hold on.
Though.
No, it gets better. It gets better. So, now, his supposedly, my grandma live in Garland.
Yes, sir.
So, a couple months later, I see him on Facebook saying he's in Garland for his grandma's funeral. Now, they live in Atlanta at this time. You know what I mean? The man she said was my father. He live in Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
He got a son in Atlanta. His son went to a university. Son built like a bodybuilder.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I seen him online, chopped it up with him. He told me, hey, my dad said he don't know you and your mama. So that's weird. Okay, I'm like, you know, I left it alone. But like I said, I look up and I see the same nigga in Garland talking about at my grandma's funeral.
Wow, he right there.
Yeah, so I'm like, okay, so. Yeah,
it don't
yeah.
make sense. It's something to it.
But,
it's too
but,
damn close
okay,
to comfort.
But then it gets better. So, you know, I see the nigga they say is my dad. He got a Facebook page now.
Mm-hmm.
I see there, boom, there he go. I look at the nigga. He don't really look like me, but I can't, you know, he an OG old nigga now. I don't know what he looked like back in the day.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I'm looking at him. Nigga don't really look like me, but. I noticed that him and my mama following each other on Facebook. I said, look, let me tell y'all something.
I would have went to mama and said, mama,
listen,
is this him?
Listen, I'd already said that. I'd already talked to him, but I talked to his son, and he said that shit. I told her, my auntie, of course, my mom and my auntie, you know, my auntie's in them all went off and shit. Like, okay. That, you know, because my auntie's in them knowing. Yeah, that nigga lying. Everybody know from Garland and shit.
He's
like
trying to tell his Cuban family from knowing that he had an outside child.
So, yeah, who knows? You know what I'm talking about?
No, that's what it is.
He probably have more than one. He probably have one.
I don't know nothing about that, but I know when we reach out to him. Yeah, yo. So the nigga ain't even show up. Man, shout out to that nigga name. Put him out there, man. Tired of this, nigga. We grown now, nigga. We're box too, nigga. You done raised some killers.
Yeah, you know
what
I mean?
But he has a Facebook page now, so you have means to reach out to him directly.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, but you already, well, you might out to
him. No, because the son, like, the son, I don't know the nigga lying, though.
Yeah, the son, you don't know that nigga.
You see what I mean? The son might be lying because
you got on them steroids. I'm going to be honest with you, bro. I know what you were saying. The nigga be up, cut up. Yeah, that ain't normal.
Yeah,
he taking any juice in
himself. I'm going to say this. Right now, you know, I have a son, my son 15. You know what I mean? I got a daughter that I just sent to Atlanta. You know what? I'm going to be honest with y'all, man. What happened in my childhood, not having no dad around and shit like that. Yeah, I went through some shit, but it made me a cold ass dad.
Really?
A cold ass dad. But I tell you, I'm cold.
Yeah.
Man, I don't miss shit. I ain't miss no goddamn basketball game, no recitals, no nothing. I didn't, you know what I mean?
That's usually what happens.
Take fully care of them. Even me and they mama separated, I don't need a dime from you. Keep everything in your purse. Don't ever pull a nickel out for them kids. I got everything. She ain't seen the inside of a barbershop. She don't know what Foot Locker look like. She don't know. What that kind of shit looks like. I do everything.
You got a boy and a girl?
I got a boy and a girl. Yep. Just sit. My daughter just turned 19.
Wow. Boy, you looking good over there.
My daughter turned 19, and I had her when I was 18. My daughter turned 19. I sent her off to Clark University, you know, in Atlanta.
Dope.
You know what I mean? So, yeah. So, you know,
that's what it's all about.
Same mom?
Same house. Yeah, no. Two kids, same house.
Okay.
Yeah, same house. Yeah,
trying to clean it up.
Christina and Chris. Yeah, two kids, really, same house. Yep, and that's the only kids I got. No other kids nowhere else. That's
man,
it.
Man, that's
see,
dope.
That's good. Yep. Because a lot of people try to do that because they didn't experience that. They want to make sure that they get it right. But some people fall right back in the same thing as their father.
Nah, we wasn't going for it. I wasn't going for it. Yeah, I knew how much, you know, growing up as a young man with no pops. Like, when I tell y'all I was out there. I was a wild nigga. Like, when I tell you, I was probably one of the worst niggas in my city. When I say that, I mean that from a sad place. Like, I was one of the worst niggas growing up, probably in the history of my city. Like, that's how fucked up I was. But I tell you, I've done everything from kicking in 40, 50 does. When I tell you, the police has raided everybody in my entire house, family house, including this nigga shit. You know what I mean? When I tell you that my mama used to wake me up in the middle of the night rubbing anointment oil on me because she thought I was possessed. Like, my mama just thought I was just an evil, crazy ass nigga. Me and my brother. You know, we was wild growing up. We didn't have no pops. So big bro out there wild, and he kicking in doughs. He selling dope. He doing everything. I'm just trying to do like big bro doing. You know, I mean, I'm just going to do what big bro doing. I got kicked out of every single school I ever went to. I never survived in no school. I got kicked out of every school in the history of me going to school.
See, and that all proves that a woman cannot be a father to a young man. Because no matter how much she try to pull you back, you know what I mean? A man could have done that.
Yeah.
When she couldn't do that. No matter how much we love and we try to do everything because we don't want to see you straight. But you gonna still do what you want to do because you're a young man.
No, mama tried. My mama a little woman too. You know, she whooped us as long as she could. Them whooping stopped hurting by 10, 11, 12. Yeah. Niggas, them whoopings wasn't hurting.
Yeah,
you know, we ain't care about.
Mama still around.
Yeah, mama look good. Mama still around. Yeah, mama around. Yeah.
How old were you when you changed your life?
That nigga ain't changed.
Yeah, I ain't changed. I'm gonna be honest, I ain't changed. You know what I mean?
That nigga still the same.
But what we mean by that
I
is
I seen
that,
his show. He the nigga turned up.
No, he changed when he had kids because you don't want them kids to be just like
saying.
You.
Know what you're saying?
I'm just giving.
But far as just being like thinking the way I think, like you say, growing up without no father, I think about that shit every day when I'm dealing with my kids. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, you get one life to live. This is it, nigga. Go hard. You know what I mean?
Because
like, these days going by fast right now too.
Sir.
I thought it was goddamn Monday today.
No, I'd be the same way.
Yeah, I thought it was Monday.
Yeah,
it's Wednesday.
So you wanted to late bloomers, I guess I would say. So how did you get into? I'm gonna get a little bit into the rap music right now. How did you get into rap? What age did you start rapping?
Man, I started rapping. I was just like a lot of cats, you know, at school in the cafeteria, kind of rapping with niggas around the way. But then what happened was I started, after school, I went to jail for a while. I remember I went to jail from like, I was in jail for maybe like 4 or 5 months of being 17. When I got out, I wasn't in school no more. I was supposed to be a junior. I just completely stopped going. I was at Lakeview and Garland. I just stopped going. And I started really trying to rap. Just writing raps all the time. So around that time, we know what niggas gonna do. I'm gonna give me a little cutie, bust them down to some Knicks. And I'm rapping every day.
You a real live rapper.
We rapping. Now remember, we gonna hustle
and
rap.
And an entrepreneur.
Yeah, we gonna hustle and rap. So I started just rapping. I started to get the attention from a lot of local niggas, like niggas around the way, just hearing that, man, nigga Crispy going in on that microphone. Nigga, man, nigga hard.
That made you more.
Yeah, we lived in these apartments, and niggas would all come from everywhere, these apartments, to freestyle with us niggas every night. Till we might have 10, 15, 20, 30 niggas out there freestyling. So I was like, you know what? Fuck that. I'm calling Head Crack at 97.9 to beat.
Already.
I'm calling Head Crack. I just called Head Crack. That nigga just picked up the phone. I said, nigga, I started dissing the niggas that was on the freestyle. I said, nigga, I'm coming up there. I want to. He said, nigga, come on. You on tomorrow. I'm like, oh, shit.
Nah, hell no. Let's do go. It.
I go up to Valley View Mall. Y'all remember 971? I go up to Valley View. He got a white boy in there. They said the white boy name is Cujo, right? Cujo. They said this white boy been up here for like damn near, nigga, 6-7 weeks. I'm like, damn. You know, Super K in the building.
Yeah.
Keynote in the building.
Shout out.
Head cracking the building. You know,
shout out.
Freestyle battle time. They cut the beat on, I go, boom. The white boy go, boom. They give me one more round, boom, boom. I killed him. You know,
easy.
And when you in there, easy. Yeah, I mean, oh man. Nigga, I've been watching Smack since goddamn Murder Mook and goddamn J. Mills.
Easy, got that nigga.
Right.
Got that nigga. I told you don't do it. Yeah, come up here.
Hey, man, when they do it on the radio, you can't hear it until you leave. You got to leave the mall. Then they gonna go through and edit it. So you go sit in the car and listen to it. So you got to listen just like everybody else. You know, they going for caller for caller, caller for caller. You know what I mean? I won. I ended up being the freestyle champ for damn near, like, I want to say like 3 or 4 months. The only thing that stopped me was I went back to jail again.
Damn.
Yeah, probation. I was always on the run from probation. Whenever I took a felony probation 5-year deferred.
Okay.
And I turned it into a 7. Wow. Every time they would let me go, I just take off running again. I would never, mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not piss testing at all. Y'all not checking my piss because I'm
How
smoking.
How did you beat it?
They just got tired of me. They got so tired of me when they finally caught me for the last time. They just said, just give us the rest of our money and just, nigga, go. I ain't even have too much community service done. Wow. You know what I mean? I got my community service done on my probation literally through the black arts of letters and ink. What's it called? T-ball. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Curtis King. Y'all ever heard of mm-hmm. Mr. King? Mm-hmm. They put me in a restitution center because I wouldn't get a job. Now, I didn't even need a job. I was looking good. I'm shining. I'm doing a little hustling. But my probation, like, nah, nigga, you need to go to work. Like, you will not. Where you getting this money from? And shit, like, you need to go to work.
Yeah.
So they put me in a restitution center, which is right across the street from T-ball. And they started sending me and other people to T-ball to do community service. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So mm-hmm. I was meeting people like Kiki Shepherd and Eddie Winslow. Eddie Winslow.
A lot of people do work through them.
Yeah, they work through them. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I never forget, I met Kim Fields one night.
Oh,
yeah.
Really?
Kim Fields coming down mm-hmm. the stairs. I said, oh, I got a big crush on Kim Fields. I see her coming down the stairs. Yeah. I reach out.
She's top heavy, too.
This is the real story.
Yeah, you seen her.
Real story.
Yeah, you run down on her.
I reach out for her hand.
Reach out for her.
She give me her hand.
Yeah, nigga, this is wait a minute. This is an R&B song, nigga. Niggas don't reach for women no more, nigga.
Say,
go ahead.
I grab her hand. I look at her. You know what I mean? At this time, she got the blonde dreads already and shit. Skin looking amazing.
That was
shit.
Before Smoking Norfolk song with and she cried on the piano. Come on.
I'm like, damn. I grab her hand. I said, man. I said, you one of my favorite characters on Living Single.
Yeah.
Sinclair.
Yeah.
She looked at me and said, what did you call me?
Yeah, you called her the wrong name.
Sinclair.
No, wrong name.
I was like, oh, shit. And what was her name on the show? It was,
No, I just would have called her Kim Fields.
It wasn't Regine. It wasn't Sinclair. It was, what was her name on the show?
It wasn't Khadija either.
No,
Khadija was the dark one, the main character. She wasn't even, she was
Regine.
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 Was it Regine?
She was, I actually called her Sinclair, and she was Regine. She took a hand away and said, nigga, what? I said, man.
I just went with facts of life, nigga.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
I done went all the way back to the nigga.
Yeah, Tootie.
Yeah, I ain't for the play with it.
That's easier to remember.
Yeah, Tootie, nigga. Yeah, you should have said, look, I used to watch Facts of Life, and I seen you even on the episode when Arnold was on there. Yeah. You know, you start, you'd have got her, nigga.
Man, I fucked it all with her, man.
Yeah, but it wasn't meant to be.
Yeah, it wasn't meant to be.
Nah, you did better anyway, man. Shout out to the one you
got with, man. You missed out Sinclair.
I was taking around that time. I mean, we had a baby mama and two kids. I was just trying, you know what I mean? I was just trying to say what's up.
So, when did you ever have a manager or somebody?
I want to know. So you got locked up. You are on top.
Yeah.
Why didn't you come back and get your throne?
Wait a minute, when
I came back,
things changed, nigga. The beeper was gone, nigga.
Person who was on top of might have been.
When I came back, let me see. When I came back this next time, I came back with a baby this time. You know, I came back home to a baby. And that was a crazy experience. I had a child while I was in jail. I was in Luce Terry too.
You was on Decker West.
They moved me around. First I was in Government Center. I started out. I was in Government Center. Then when they gave me, I went to court. They gave me the chemical dependency program. Oh, I lived on New Hollis. My first couple times, I lived in the birdcage, nigga. I was there for like 5-6 months. Nigga. Yeah, I lived in the birdcage. Yeah, nigga. I lived in the birdcage. But now, Government Center was worse than that damn birdcage. They no guards in there.
Yeah, that's right.
They was letting niggas do what they want to do. I got high in the Government Center.
Yeah, it's coming through.
That was a crazy high, nigga, in jail. Oh, man, we rapped all night, nigga. I'm thinking about rapping. Nigga got high in Government Center and rapped all night. But
being the type of father that you say you are, how did it feel not being there to see your child being born?
To be honest with you, I didn't know at the time. You know what I mean? Because remember, I don't got no kids. I'm a teenager. I don't even know.
Oh, she didn't call and be like.
She can't call me. I'm in jail, so all I can do is keep calling home to see when she had her. That's all I can do. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. That's all you can do in jail is keep calling home. You know what I mean? I'm in the county.
So when did you find out?
I found out on Halloween. My daughter was born on the 30th. I found out on Halloween.
And you were, you know what I mean? You were locked
in. One of my aunties, I called my grandma's house, and one of my aunties answered the phone and told me she was born. Then they sent me pictures of her. They sent me Christmas photos of her. You know what I'm talking about? Right. And that's when it really hit a nigga. That's when I was under them goddamn blankets at night, nigga, over there trembling.
I gotta get the hell up out of here,
niggas,
man.
Yeah, that shit real. Yeah. Niggas don't know about that. I'm gonna eat them goddamn copy. I'm playing tough all day, but when them lights go out, I'm over there crying about it. I put the toothpaste on the back of these damn pictures and put them on my window.
It's a hard time.
Were you there for your second one when second was born? Most definitely,
yep. My son was born. Yep, I cut the umbilical cord every day.
Kind of help you to grow too, though.
Yeah,
I call that the 3 days of dying. Like when you go through certain situations, God be really cleaning you up.
Yeah,
and it's a cleansing time. So the time when you're hurting, you're really being pulled and thrown to something different.
Yeah,
and it's on a whole nother level because you know it's hidden the right way. That right there is isolation, man.
Yeah,
and at the end of the day, it's really the time to get your mind right.
You gotta get your mind right, bro.
Yeah,
got
yeah,
to,
yeah. You know what so, I mean? So after you get out, how did you get back into rapping? I'm gonna go right back into rap,
man. Well, when I got out, like she asked to have a manager, and that's what happened, man. I started rocking with a lot of local cats. Salute to my guys TMA. Salute to Doski G.
Doski G. Yeah, I talked to him, Mr. Lucci called me and he was on the phone.
Salute to Deontay. It was a lot of niggas just, you know, around the way locally that I was always rocking with and doing music with, you know what I mean? And then I seen they got signed. They took off. But Doski G and Deontay ended up signing with Stony Crook. You know, they ended up doing their thing. I ended up getting down with my partners TMA to Grind Records. We was all just out there rapping, man. So I remember when they put the NDA together, you know, the North Dallas Alliance, they put the NDA together, that's when Lil Will had that big hit, My Dougie.
My Dougie.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, them niggas snatched it from California. I'll never forget it.
Yeah, he had that Busted Wide Open. He had a couple of hits. But around that era, you know, Lucci, all them niggas, T-Cash, Monster, Big Moan, Stubbaline. Shout out to all them niggas from that era of niggas, because I was just amongst them niggas, you know, learning the game, doing music, doing songs with different niggas. But then along came a white boy named JT Barnett that changed the game.
Wow.
JT Barnett came along. He was a videographer, and he ended up working for the show Cheetahs. You know, he was one of the producers of the show Cheetahs. So I'm rapping at this time. Well, I'm rapping. We ain't making no money yet off this rap shit. So he worked for Cheetahs. So he tell me, hey, look, you want to work for Cheetahs? And I'm like, fuck it, you're right. I started doing everything for Cheetahs. I started doing security work for Cheetahs. I started doing PA work for Cheetahs. I started actually producing episodes of Cheetahs. You know, I became like one of his like secret go-to guys for episodes. So he finally just gave me the go with the green light and was like, I'm going to let you start handling episodes for Cheetahs. So a lot of episodes of Cheetahs people have seen, I produced them.
Wow.
I have a question for that. You said you did security.
Yeah, yeah.
What's the craziest thing you've seen during Cheetahs where you had to deal with it?
Well, I mean, the craziest shit is the venue not knowing we showing up, because see, Cheetahs will do you dirty. They won't tell a venue they coming sometime.
Yeah.
So if you show up to a hotel and they don't know y'all coming, they gonna sick real security on y'all. So I done worked for Cheetahs running from the police like I'm finna go to jail. Me wow. and different staff members, we gone. Everybody
trying to
running.
Get that footage.
Yeah, trying to get that goddamn footage. Yeah.
And it's worth it, man. Yep. Good show, great vibe, yeah. man.
Hey, you know when y'all stay up?
What's up?
When the dude got stay up.
You know what? That was right before me, but I'm I'm going to say this. As of right now, I work for Cheetahs again. I just really? Started working for Cheetahs
again. So what's that nigga name over there?
Peter Gunn.
You Peter Gunn.
I said, put me on there with y'all.
So a lot of stuff in Cheetahs you'll see, I'm just going to say it's all crazy. You know what I'm talking about? Wow. But yeah, I'm back with the show. So you know, before that, you would have caught me going in. But yeah, I'm back with the show. Shout out to JT Barnett. JT Barnett also worked on the Tiger King.
Wow.
You know what I mean? Yeah, and I remember when he was telling me about that. Hey, I got this gay white dude in Oklahoma with all these tigers and shit. He'd come down here with me. I'm like, hell nah, nigga, that shit sounds stupid.
Yeah.
And it ended up turning into the Tiger King.
Wow.
You know what I mean? So that was in Oklahoma. But I got down with JT Barnett. I worked with Cheetahs. We start, you know, just doing music while working with Cheetahs. Next thing you know, we doing shows and we bump into Lil Flip.
Okay.
You know what I mean? We bump into Lil Flip and his people. And one of the little Flip partners named Golden Child, he just took a liking to us.
Okay.
You know, we started talking with him. He brought us around Flip. Flip took a big liking to us. You know, Flip was telling me, listen to my music. I want to bring you on the squad. I want to sign you. I want to bring JT Barnett with me, too. I want y'all to start, you know, y'all going to be Clover G's and bring y'all on the squad. So that's what we did.
Was this the time? What Flip was this? Was this the Flip
before? This is right after T.I.
This is right after T.I. That was a hard deal right there with Tip, nigga.
Yeah, that was this is right after T.I. shit. This is like about 07, 08.
Man, I was mad about that whole dang situation.
Yeah, man.
It was horrible.
Yeah.
And I didn't like it because we had the whole thing working at the time.
Yeah, man.
And it was basically screw music and all kind of stuff that got, people don't know how everything got disassembled after that. I see that as a dividing point for us losing pretty much we had Essence, bro. We had Flip had the biggest thing going because Sony had done signed him, and he, you know, people were jealous like they always get. Niggas get jealous. All the rappers got jealous that was from even Houston, and we can talk about it now. But then, you know, basically I was a big Lil Flip fan. Even when he decided that, okay, I'm going to go against T.I., I didn't know Tip, so I was with Flip. Yeah. And to be honest with you, I'm from Texas. So,
real shit.
But when Scarface did that, man, it was some crazy stuff went on in my head. I'm like, man, these niggas were just trying to sign him. I think that was a lot of jealousy.
Yeah, Def Jam South.
A lot of jealousy, man.
Yeah, man. You know, I mean, you know, Flip was one of them niggas who made it. A lot of young niggas in Texas want to do their thing because we had never seen that. Now it was different. We seen what Jay Prince, you know, and Rap-A-Lot had done, you know, with Ghetto Boys and all that. But Lil Flip,
shout out to Prince.
Yeah, shout out to Prince. But Lil Flip was the new era.
You know, he was
that new era of young niggas, very braggadocious, talking about them diamonds, them cars, that Serb, the pop trunk, all this shit. You know, and we know niggas like Kiki and Fat Pat, them niggas have been putting it down, doing it, but Flip was like that new era of it. He was like the young Flip nigga, 20 years old.
Flip was able to deal with some levels that they wasn't able to attain because he was able to really cross over somewhat.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't see that. He was able to deal with, you know, I remember when he was like, everybody was loving, this is the way we ball.
Man, and come on.
I mean, it was a good time for Texas, man, and for the South.
Yeah.
Because it really was a Southern thing, to be honest with you.
I remember hearing all his freestyles and going to, shout out to George Lopez, them niggas at T-Town.
You been on here?
Yeah.
My guy right there.
Yeah, salute to George. Them niggas was slanging them goddamn CDs out of T-Town.
Bad, nigga.
Them boys slanging them.
That's
goddamn
how DSR
CDs.
Got on. Niggas don't realize that.
Yeah.
And they kept putting it in our face.
Yeah, he's slanging CDs.
Slanging CDs. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So, once you met with Flip and you guys did some projects together?
I started working with Flip.
Okay.
I started recording with Flip. We started doing a lot of shit. And I'm still working with JT Barnett. I'm still shooting reality show pilots and all kind of shit. But it was a lot of cats I ran into while being down with Clover G's. I did a reality show pilot called School of Beats, where I gathered up a couple producers, and one of the producers was Mr. E.
Okay.
Triple D revenge movie.
I know you're talking about.
Yeah, he was one of the producers on the show. Had other niggas. So working with Flip, it gave me a bigger opportunity to say I'm a rap and continue to do some of this shit we doing with JT Barnett.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So with the music shit, I'm gonna say this, with the music, I wasn't as focused as I should have been. You know what I mean? Yeah, I was cocky with it.
Let me just stop you for a minute, because, you know, shout out to Rainwater. Say you old rapping niggas is the one that hold really the whole disgruntled rapping niggas that hold the city from coming up, because the young niggas trying to come up.
Yeah.
And I'm just paraphrasing, but that's kind of what he alludes to a lot.
That's exactly
what
he means.
You've heard him say that, right?
And the nigga, I talked to the nigga several times on the phone, nigga said that.
So do you agree with that?
I'm gonna say like this. Nobody should ever give up their dreams. You know, you got niggas who 40 years old still go play ball, even though they're not going to the NBA, they still want to play a pickup game of basketball. So I'm not going to tell nobody to stop recording and rapping over beats if that's what you like. But if you are older and you got that, you know, you got that knowledge like I feel like I have now, I'd rather use that to help one of the younger niggas out. That's just how I look at it now. Everybody got, you know, everybody don't look at it like me. That. But I would rather take my experience in the game and go, like, I went and linked up with T-Baller today and went and sat down with one of his artists and watched his music and shit, and he put me on to him. And, you know, so now on my show, I'm going to go play some of his shit. I would rather do that. I would rather put on for the young artists right now. But you got some OGs that still want to rap. You know what I mean? And I ain't knocking them for that. If niggas still want to rap, that's what they do. But far as me, I feel like if you an OG, take that game and that knowledge you got, and let's come on, let's help these young niggas out.
Yeah, and that's what it's all about. Just making sure that we, you know, do what it takes to pass it to the next generation.
Yeah,
that's our biggest problem. We've always been wanting to kill the dream, our people. You know what I mean? We fathers not being in the home. You seen it, so it just perpetuates itself into something, even into the music industry, which is really entrepreneurship. Yeah. It's holding us back. We have the ball. It's one of the greatest things to see the control that the music has over the people of the other cultures.
Yeah.
So we need to make sure we think of that and stop thinking of just ourselves and what we like and not supporting the new stuff that the younger generation brings out. So do you, you know, a lot of niggas say that, you know, you came up on Mo 3's legacy of him passing away. Now all of a sudden you come in here and you start, the reason you own is because Mo 3 passed away. I want to hear your answer. I ain't going to tell you mine to the end.
Yeah. I'm going to say this. I'm going to say my knowledge, you heard me just give out some of my backstory. So you can see I've been in this hip hop shit for forever. Now, did I come in around that time? Yeah, that's the time I came in. At the time, we was thinking about doing a show for like damn near a year. I had been thinking about what am I going to do on YouTube, because Lil Flip started his own show.
That's what I was going to say.
Lil Flip started a show called The Truth Shall Set You Free Podcast. Now, I'm not going to lie to you. When Lil Flip started that show, I thought I was going to be the co-host of the goddamn show.
And it wasn't.
I was like, okay, yeah, this is my time. We were doing a lot of filming at Real Life Street Star. So I'm like, okay, bet. I'm pulling up. But as I get there, it's a nigga named DJ Hard Hitter that pull up. I'm looking like, who the fuck is this nigga? You know, nigga, bunch of chains on and shit, nigga rattling, walking around the room and shit. I'm looking like, who this nigga is? So, and I had seen him online before. I knew who Hard Hitter was. That's my guy. Salute to Hard Hitter. That's my nigga.
Yeah.
But I'm like, I'm thinking that seat going to be mine. I just know it.
Yeah.
Flip was like, nah, I'm going to let Hard Hitter do it, you know, because we're going to do a lot of episodes in Houston, too. And, you know, Hard Hitter be, you know, be traveling back and forth with me. So I'm like, all right, bet. You know, I didn't trip. But I sat in there with Flip still. I still helped them niggas out, came up with different
humble.
Shit. You know, yeah, humble. Played humble. The background scene, you know. Yeah. I'm watching everybody
P.O.P.
work.
P.O.P. say he be the sixth man.
Yeah.
Yeah, sometimes you got to see. Yeah, ain't nothing
and
wrong
so
with that.
I was humble. I'm just watching what they doing, how the show running. I'm helping them out with a lot of shit, coming up with different concepts for them to talk about different shit. He put a spin board together with different things you could do. I would go and help him with all that shit. I would just humbly play my role. But I was also scheming.
Because
I'm up there with Real Life Street Stars. We're going to tell the story about Real Life Street Stars, too, real fast. Real Life Street Stars is was some guys who I had been working with a long time ago. They came into the game, and when they came into the game, I was the first nigga to ever go viral and ever make niggas talk about them.
Wow.
When they came into the game, they were just doing, the name of their show was Real Talk, No Bullshit. That was the name of their show when they first started.
My cousin them know them. I don't really know them. I never met them.
Shout out to my nigga Rook, my nigga Joker, my nigga Jeff.
I think I met Jeff. But I just seen him. I don't know him. Yeah. I don't know nobody. I pulled up, nigga. I don't know nobody. I'm a country nigga.
But you in the building though.
I'm free. I came in this thing, and I tell you when we off the cameras, but I always was incognito. Like I ain't the one, but at the end of the day, I seen what everybody was doing, I definitely love the way the vlogging thing is going in Dallas. You guys are dope, man.
Yeah,
the whole thing, not just no one entity.
Yeah,
everything that's when, the it, whole to shit. Me. That's why you here today, because my brother and me think about bringing the whole thing, like trying to bring people and the way they think, and to a place to where we all can say when a nigga come to town. Hey man, go check such and such. Like my boy when Charlie Lowe Jr. just came. Like or hell, when my boy brought Pimpin' Caprice or whatever. Anytime a nigga come through, you know, we supposed to be able to show each other love. Nigga, quit worrying about, you a real hustler. You worry, I'm worried about the money. Now I don't be tripping on the money. I've been getting money so long, nigga. I ain't flexing.
Yeah,
but I ain't just a nigga that ain't out here doing it like that.
Nigga ain't stressing over a dollar like that.
I never was one. I always, nigga, you talk about you used to rob, nigga, and do it. Nigga, I'm an old nigga, man. I never went without, bro.
Yeah.
Hey, how you deal with criticism? How you deal with criticism?
Ah, man, I've been dealing with it for so long, nigga. Shit, you know, getting down with a little Flip, nigga. Damn, nigga, you talking about hell. Shit, you talking about niggas. You talking about hearing about T.I. everywhere you goddamn go, this and that, a million questions.
Y'all have to get serious on some occasions dealing with Tip?
Ah, man, you know, it was a lot of times. I mean, it was a lot of times where niggas walked in clubs. I remember when that record Ain't I came out. I remember that record came out. I never forget. We would go to clubs and shit, man. Like, when we would walk in, that would be like the signal for the DJ to throw the goddamn song on.
Really?
Yeah, you deal with shit like that from time to time. You walk in the club, they just throw T.I. on.
Yeah, and how did that, did y'all get upset?
Nah, I mean, niggas knew what time it was, you know, but you gotta, you know, that might start some shit up. Like, I never forget one time we in the club, right, we all walk in. I'm with the Houston, we in Dallas. I'm with the Houston niggas. We walk in, they throw Ain't I on. You know, I see Toro and them niggas. I don't know if y'all, you know, Toro.
Okay, what happened?
Niggas on the other side. The niggas that hit niggas up and shit across the room and shit.
Oh, they don't.
I'm looking like, hold on. I got to slide over and tell them niggas, hold on, nigga. I'm over there with them niggas. We good, yeah, niggas. Clover G, yeah. Oh, okay, yeah, we good, everybody. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just weird how that shit would go with, you know what I mean, with that T.I. and Lil Flip shit. I mean, we go certain places, it's love. But then sometimes it'd be like some weird shit going on with, you know, with certain niggas. But nah, overall, man, nowadays, I mean, it's love. I mean, supposedly them niggas done chopped it up a couple times and shit like that. So it was a dope battle back then. You know, hey, you know, it went the way it went. You know, hey, niggas did it for hip hop, I feel like. You know what I mean? Regardless of who called who out, they did it for hip hop.
Let me ask you, so, I mean, does that annoy you when people say you use Mo3 to make your platform look a certain way?
Nah, not at all, bro. You know what I mean? Because the thing about it is, I show Mo3 love and respect. And if you're not a 635 nigga, you know what I'm talking about? If you're not from that direction, from that north side, from Garland, from them apartments and all that shit, then niggas don't understand. You know what I mean? When that, we was already wanting to do a show. Like I said, Flip was doing his. I was looking for a way to get mine started. When Mo3 passed away, I didn't jump right into it, but I was watching Big D the Mogul.
Yeah, you know what
I
mean? Boy.
Yeah, salute to Big D the Mogul. I had been watching him grind because I got a partner named DK and he was on the show, and I had been start watching Big D, and that's when I decided that I wanted to start doing shit. Mo3 passes away. I see Big D the Mogul interview Rainwater.
That's right.
And I seen him interview Rainwater. I'm watching, that's a good ass interview. And then like a week or so went by and I realized nobody else ain't interviewed the nigga. You know, it was some more questions I wanted Big D to ask him. It was some more shit. It's the time to start the show. This the time to start the show. Fuck it. I'm going to be the nigga to ask him some more shit. I hit up Rainwater. We set it up. We did it on Instagram.
Wow.
I did it on Instagram and transferred it over to YouTube, and we ended up doing like 130,000 views on it. A lot of people don't know. I got monetized on YouTube with one video. I did that one interview, nigga. I got 4,000 watch hours, 1,000 subs, nigga.
Hey.
Nigga got monetized off one video coming in the door. Yep, first video got monetized.
So I seen, it was a deal. I know I seen where one time you defended, I guess, I won't say defended, like you had a diss against Slim Thug and all them niggas on one.
Yeah,
seen that. I was like, damn, that nigga there just jump out there butt naked. Look, he don't care, swinging at everybody.
Back to Real Life Street Stars. That's them niggas. That was their first interview that ever blew up. That was,
what about the other one? It was also,
What about Trap Boy? You've had
Trap Boy actually, it was an issue with Trap. I did an interview with a nigga named Jackpot. All right.
Okay.
Jackpot came home from the pen, did 10 years flat. Jackpot, an Oak Cliff nigga. Jackpot used to be best friends with Earl Spence. They was all in the same crew together.
Okay.
Jackpot comes home, he get a hold of me. He tell me, hey man, I got some music, this and that, but I also got a story I want to tell. When the nigga told me the story about him taking time for Earl Spence and him making, and Earl Spence was supposed to take the time, but Earl Spence's father begged him not to, because his son was going to the Olympics. Can you take all the time for that nigga? Tell him that he wasn't there.
Story.
Yeah, I'm like, nah, I don't want to fuck with that story. You know, at first I'm like, nah, I don't know, nigga. Like, that's some shit. But as time went on, I talked to Jackpot again. I talked to his manager. And the main thing was I liked the nigga music. You know what I'm talking about? Before we did the interview, I heard his music. I like the music. I like the record. I say, you know what? I got to let this nigga tell his story, man. Wow. Let this nigga come here and tell the story. He come tell the story about, you know, how, you know, he basically, him and they was all in some shit. He took the full case. He didn't say nothing about them guys being there. He said that he sent me all the receipts of Earl Spence wearing the free Jackpot shirts. They call him Dude. His name is Dude. Free Dude. His rap name is Jackpot. But the free little Dude shirts. And, you know, he sent me the JPays where the nigga was sending him and his family was sending him money. And he said that he was promised by his dad and Errol Spence that when he got home, he had nothing to worry about. Fam, you good. You took that time, nigga. When you get out, you good. I mean, this is Jackpot's story. He said, nigga said, when I come home, I'm good. I got a job, whatever. You know, I ain't gotta be out here like this. I'm good. He said he came home. He never heard shit from Earl Spence. He said they went out one night and he never heard from Earl again. He said he even sent Earl a $25,000 Cash App request. Nigga said Earl Spence declined the shit and blocked the nigga. You know what I mean? So yeah, so when that happened, I think I'm not for sure. I guess Trap Boy felt some kind of way. You know what I'm talking about? Trap felt some kind of way and he jumped in my on the Instagram post of the video that I was gonna do that night on YouTube about the story, and he told me, nigga, I'm you got zero chances left. We tired of you, nigga. You know what I mean? So that's what Trap Boy said. So eventually I did a little episode, you know, speaking on that and shit like that. At the end of the day, I'm a real nigga, fam. Like, I don't nigga, fuck all that shit. You know what I'm talking about? Like, young nigga, get your mind right. You feel me?
So when this happened, did you guys ever straighten it out?
No, I never talked to him. You know, I never talked to him. I never talked to none of them niggas. You know, I didn't talk to Earl Spence. I didn't talk to Yella Beezy. Because at the end of the day, I'm gonna be honest with you, I didn't feel like it was my job to talk to him. I feel like, nigga, I'm a show host. You know, I conduct a show. This man got his own story. Fam, all I did was gave that man the floor to speak his story. Wow. You know what I mean? I don't think I owe you niggas no kind of explanation, nigga, and I'm not. If I bumped into Earl Spence tomorrow, I wouldn't say sorry to the nigga. Nigga, it ain't my story, nigga. That nigga said you owe him some money, nigga. Wow. I don't know you, nigga.
That is crazy, man. Like, now, nigga, you know, I never I don't know that story. You, nigga. What do you think about this story, Money Man?
I think it's true.
What?
All of it.
Oh, sure. Hell. That's my nigga. I think it's true.
All of them act like hoes. The only one that was Trap Boy at times, but all of them act like hoes, man.
Yeah, so
Trap Boy probably on the real one it is.
Out of who?
Yellow, Earl.
Man, I'm a Yellow fan. I can't say that.
You can be a fan down there. Yeah, you're not a hoe because it's really good.
I just know that I'm a big time. Like I love the city.
Yeah.
Like I always tell Rain and everybody to come on this show. If I'm talking to anybody, I don't care who it is. At some point, you got to start trying to come together.
Yeah.
Now, my co-host crazy as hell. He don't care. He going to say what he feel.
Yeah. Hey, come on. Hey, fuck it, nigga. I keep 100, man.
Yeah, but the thing is, I just say that at some point, you guys are pinnacles for the city.
Yeah.
We got to start acting like it. Nigga been getting money so long. Show the youngsters how to get money.
Yeah.
Quit thinking about yourself and your reputation and your machismoism, nigga. Ain't nobody, how big your chest is, how tall your truck set.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Come on, my nigga. Y'all, we already been winning.
Winning.
Y'all gonna let the young niggas win? Or y'all just gonna continue to cut up? We gonna kill each other?
Yeah.
If I also do, I'll snitch now.
Who?
I'll snitch on Earl.
Oh, if you was on what?
I'll snitch on his ass. I'll bring shit out. He back
but
up.
But I think
now,
it's
nigga.
Already
but
over.
But you see, but think about it, Jackpot already back in jail again.
Again.
You know? Yeah, he went back, he did 10 flat, now he back in there. They trying to fight to get him out. You know, so
I still snitch.
You know, maybe Earl didn't want the nigga around because he felt the nigga was wild or some shit like that. You know,
it could have been anything.
You never know. So
man trying to get his career together,
and he helped Earl get his career together.
Yeah,
he
real talk. Hey, that's real shit though. That's real shit. Yeah, he helped you. You know what I mean? That's what Jack said.
I bring it all down too, nigga.
Yeah, but when you help somebody, a lot of times you evolve too in time. And if that person can't grow with you, man, it's gonna bring your stuff down. You can't take everybody with you, bro.
Yeah.
I don't care how y'all look at it. I done seen niggas come up. You got niggas like Jamie Foxx came up. I went down there to Terrell. They said, man, I used to teach that nigga how to play the drums. I used to teach that nigga how to sing. Yeah. He was singing. There's another nigga down here singing just as good as him. Man, my brother was his best friend, kept nigga from beating him up. Yeah, but still, nigga, that nigga worth $80 million. You worth $80. Yeah. I know. Come on, what we got to talk about?
He worth $80 because of me.
Yeah, see what I mean?
I don't want to hear that
shit,
man. But
you cannot get listen. These people.
Let me
you
go to jail with somebody. Yeah, watch what happens.
Hey, when nigga
watch
do 10 flat, man. Yeah, nigga feel some kind of way if a nigga do 10 flat.
I'm going back to
10 flat, 10. He did 10 flat. Yeah, he did 10 years. He got locked up. He had 18 to 28.
He had an opportunity. He was out here. If he felt some type of way, he could have went and addressed that.
Yeah,
he's going back to jail anyway.
Yeah, nigga. Yeah,
so
yeah,
you know, niggas everywhere go anywhere. Nigga, yeah,
free jackpot, man. I actually got the nigga some shows booked and everything. You know, I started talking to him, trying to look out for him and shit. You know what I mean? I got him some shows booked, and his shit didn't go, you know, the way I wanted to go with it because he got locked up. You know what I'm talking about? So,
listen, man.
At the end of the day, all you can do is give a nigga a chance, man.
All y'all talking about is the devil's work, man. Divide and conquer. It's so easy. I see it so easy.
Yeah,
nigga, try and get bread out here. You can't get no money if you want to stay broke, busting and discussing. Keep on. Being divided.
Yeah.
You ain't gonna never come together. Atlanta got something special going on down there. When it comes to the music, they drop all that
just
stuff.
Just like Houston did. Houston had something special.
Well, yeah. Dallas ain't got it.
Well, Dallas ain't never
had
it.
What I'm saying, and they can.
They can.
If we change the conversations and if we try to build together.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, most definitely. We had an all-star lineup of young niggas coming up not too long ago.
And nobody harder than Mo 3.
Yeah, we had Yellow Bees.
Yeah, we had it.
We had
Trap Boy Freddy. But it was divided. Wasn't nobody stepping up trying to pull them together.
We had
had a lot of niggas out here that would hang out with them, but they wasn't trying to put them niggas together, man. Yeah. If they was, I mean, it would be some stories coming out right now where we brought them together and we, you know.
Well, but, I did hear a story about, I seen Sean Cotton tell the story about about Jay Prince, right?
Yeah,
he told it here about Jay Prince talking to Mo 3.
I hear you, but I still say there's a lot more parties involved. It ain't just Sean Cotton, you know.
But you gotta remember too, young niggas, man, you know, as older niggas, man, we can tell these young niggas a million times, y'all niggas, you know, live your life, do this, do that.
Yeah,
it's a lot of cats that told them young niggas, hey man, y'all niggas let that shit go. Y'all get money, live your life, take care of your families and shit. But you know, when it comes to this music shit, a lot of niggas feel like, well, this is what they want to see anyway. The fans want to see us do this shit. Yeah. A lot of these niggas do this shit for the fans.
No,
you know,
right.
They feel like, man, when we go at each other, nigga, the numbers go up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Same with the content creators.
Yeah,
the same shit.
Thing.
When people see Charleston White in a Crip Mac or a Bosco, man, they turning up. They watching that shit. We want to see these niggas go.
Yeah.
Black entertainment has been like that from the start.
Well,
you know what I mean?
Hands down, I had Charleston White on here. He said he was like Bruce Lee. He out here kicking all these niggas. You know what? When it comes to the conversation, who?
I say he is. Yeah. Other night, he
I'm just saying who can deal with that cat?
The other night, he came on my show last week. Okay, he came on the show, and it's another guy by the name of Most Hated Blogger.
Okay, yeah, I heard him.
Okay, so Most Hated Blogger, you know, he was, I asked Charleston White after we did an interview for an hour, I said, hey, you know, I'm going to bring a couple of people up. You know, we do the stream yard, right? So, you know, we bring niggas up during the, that's like a talk show. We bring niggas up during the interview.
Oh, that's a problem right there.
So I knew it was,
problem.
But I made sure I asked Charleston, you cool when we bring people up? Yeah, Charleston cool. He in the whip chilling, smoking a blunt. Yeah, nigga, bring him on up, nigga. I bring a female up there. She talked to him. Hey, Charleston, blah, blah, blah. Cool. Next in line. I'm going in order. Most Hated Blogger. He's next. He come up there. He tell Charleston White. He say, you know what? I'm going to save that. I say it to you when I see you in person. Charleston lost it. Charleston, hold on. What the fuck you mean when you see me in person, nigga? He said, nah, don't worry about that. He said, well, I want to talk about Timothy Simpkins, the young man who shot up the school. And you know, he said, I know for a fact that you sent Timothy Simpkins in there to shoot the school up, nigga.
Oh, man.
Yeah, that's what Most Hated Blogger told Charleston White was, nigga, you sent that young man in that school to shoot them folks. After that, Charleston White blacked out. They went, you know what I mean, Charleston, they go at it. You know, Charleston go faster. He's a little louder.
Hey, you can't tell me no shit like that.
You can't, you know what I mean, can't nobody really out-rap Charleston. You know what I'm talking about? Niggas know that. Charleston gonna get the rapping on your ass. They got to go in for a second. They got the rapping. I thought, Charleston said, all right, fuck this nigga. I'm gone. Let's go.
come on, man. Really?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I'm gonna be honest with you, though, nigga. That was pay-per-view. When I seen MHB pop up in Charles and White, I just kind of grabbed my popcorn and sit back like, hey, man, I think the internet want to see this shit. I'm not for sure. You know what I mean? Because both of them niggas go hard. They both do their shit. So I was like, hey, two grown ass men, let them go.
Ain't nobody had much practice at it as Charleston. Nah, man. That's when you spar all the time with everybody.
I heard that nigga cussing somebody out in church one day. Did y'all hear that? That nigga was cussing somebody ass out in church.
Ain't nothing wrong with it.
I said, God damn, I knew Charleston was different.
I heard you said that you, at first, you didn't really rock with Charleston.
No, I didn't. At first, when I first seen Charleston White, I was like, who is my first video seeing of him was him saying, Dallas niggas ain't shit. Dallas niggas let the Mexican niggas do this. You Dallas, you fuck Dallas niggas. I'm like, who the fuck is this nigga? That's how we all feel like, who is this? It's a four-way nigga, like, so yeah, that was the first video I really seen. So I was like, man, hell, Charles, that nigga weird. That nigga's be on some goofy shit until I seen the case with the young man out of Fort Worth. He went to jail. He got locked up for was it shooting a baby?
Yeah.
When I started to pay attention to that case, when I started to see what Charleston was saying, I was like, oh, I see what's going on now. He just break it down the way the white people would break it down to your ass. Exactly. He just uncut and raw and going to say exactly what you don't want to hear because, nigga, I'm being honest. Like, you niggas can take it how you want, but this is the God's truth.
Yeah.
So I think Charleston White's message is now, I believe Charleston White is one of the most dopest niggas in DFW. And I believe that, yeah, he pop a lot of shit, but I understand now with me being in this internet world, you got to pop your shit. You got shit on niggas while giving a good message. You gotta tell them, you know what I mean? You gotta do it. So
I think a lot of people don't get it. I hear people talking about it. I have people to come on and tell me, man, I don't like this nigga. Such and such. And I'll be like, do you even know him?
No, I get it.
You know, the stuff is, it's like, it's crazy how this whole thing, you know, how it happens, you know, just like with the No Jumpers, you know, like I said, with us going back and forth right now because of Charleston, because they decided to say something about Charleston, and I asked a question on here. It was like, hey, man, you know, why these cats coming at you? He don't know, he ain't never been on their show, but they just, people see the character on the internet, and they want to go in on it, but then when you say something back, then they want to start trying to say, oh, man, I didn't mean that. I'm like, yeah, why they keep saying something? No, you guys asked for that, you know what I mean? This is what, and then y'all keep talking back and forth. So what we supposed to? And then we in Texas, so I'm, you know, Texas folk proud, man.
Especially when it's against out of state niggas. We gotta hold them down.
Yeah, but
man.
And shout out to, I mean, I like I said, the dude dope. They got almost 4 million subscribers.
You talking about Adam 22 and the boys?
Yeah, they dope.
The No Jumper podcast is dope.
They can't come at Boss Talk. We just getting in here. Y'all already trying to swing at us?
Yeah,
we ain't trying.
But you know what?
Hold on. That's a good thing because if we don't go with the big fish, who we go with?
No, you're right.
Small
fish,
right?
But you know what? I want to point out too on my show tonight. I think it's a big difference though between between black interviewers and white interviewers.
Real talk.
I feel like these niggas let these white boys kind of say what the fuck they want to say.
Yeah, they do.
I feel like if a nigga says some of this shit, they ask y'all look at a nigga like, nigga, what? What you ask? Snip police ass nigga. But, you know, when you see Adam 22 and Vlad, they ask some questions that you be like,
what? Yeah, and nobody ever questioned it. Nobody ever questioned it.
They ain't in the streets like us. So they're not going to ask the same question we ask. They're going to ask from a white person standpoint of view.
But that's the thing about it is, but listen, it sounds like that's the act.
Yeah,
we don't know. Turn us on the game. Do you used to sell dope or not? Like, nigga, what? What? Like, nigga, you dig? So I think when a nigga asks the question, like you said, we just expect for a nigga to already know better. Nigga, I ain't even answer that shit. But when a white boy asks, they know how to disguise it real good. So, you know, I'm not a part of the culture, man. You know, just break it down to me, man. What's it like being in the hood? You're part of the 7-Trick Gangsters.
A lot of that, they playing.
Yeah, they playing. That's what I'm saying.
They've been in the game. They've been around it too long.
And that's what
and Adam 22 as well, because I seen since we've been going back and forth with them how he bringing these questions out, and every day his show been about Charleston.
Yeah,
with each person he been talking to mostly, so it's like it's going into each situation.
Yeah,
Crip Mac come on, then you get Crip these Mac guys back on. You want to talk about your issue? And then I see the views. I say, okay, I see what you're doing, bro. Yeah. But at the end of the day, you playing the I'm a victim role. You know what I'm saying? So when I look at it, man, you know, I love the fact that, look how Texas got all these bloggers here, man. We got more than anybody.
Hey, I bumped in the Cottonmouth the other night.
Oh, yeah?
I bumped in the Cottonmouth. He was at the Roy Lee documentary.
Yeah. Shout out to my boy, the nigga that did that. He came on the
Vincent,
show.
My nigga Vincent Grind. I grew up with that nigga. Another nigga I grew up with.
Yeah.
That's my partner. Salute to Vincent Grind. documentary that was dope. Salute to Roy Lee, Baby Mama, Brandy, all of them. Sure. She came on my show. Me and her did like 180,000 views dope, on, dope. You know what I mean, on an interview. So salute to her. Yeah, I seen Cottonmouth, and Cottonmouth kept asking everybody, man, nigga, is the bloggers the new rappers around this motherfucker? I'm taking pictures, nigga. I'm signing autographs.
Yeah.
All the rappers stand around
I'm
looking.
I'm running from that.
Yeah, all hey, them niggas stand around looking. Nigga, but I'm getting it on,
you
dope, nigga.
Though. That, I mean, yeah. You, I mean, you, it's just you learning how to evolve. Most niggas don't know how, and that's the whole game, you know. The fact that you grinding, that's a grind that you're doing, man.
Yeah.
Everybody else sitting back. The rappers don't be doing nothing really. No. The older rappers can't get a show.
Yeah.
You done found a way to figure it out.
Media. We in this thing.
You see what I'm saying?
We weren't talking to rappers.
And if they was helping them. I talked to them.
Y'all helping us.
We the DJs.
I talked to Mr. Pookie. Y'all help us. And Mr. Pookie, I said, man, you do a Rap Talk 101 and do the old school rappers. I be trying to give the and it was him and somebody else I was going to put together. But anyway, I'm just trying to figure out a way to help people, because people want to hear from those people. Yeah. And at the end of the day, when people come into town, the older rappers or whoever, they can come on these shows and they can make money and bring it, revamp their brand. But you gotta hustle though.
Yeah, you gotta hustle.
You gotta hustle.
Salute to my nigga Rainwater. Me and Rainwater was talking about, you know, putting something together. You know what I mean? So maybe a versus battle between, you know, maybe a Mr. Lucci and a Tum Tum. You know what I mean? So
yeah.
We talking about maybe doing something for Texas, doing something for the city, you know, because let's be honest, the show Versus ain't calling none of you niggas. So
at all.
Somebody gotta give y'all flowers.
Let's talk about that for a second. Yeah. Why do you think that first of all of the patriarchs, the real people who people look at in the South, they look at them and they respect them, the ones who have had good runs.
Yeah.
But then they disrespect them by not even getting caught up into trying to even do a versus battle with them or talk to the South about different. That's what Pimp C really was getting on them niggas about, really.
Because
when you look at it, I look at different things, man, and I see what you just said. That kind of stuff hit you. You touched the nerve when you said that. Like, oh, there ain't nobody else calling them.
Yeah, like versus,
why?
Yeah.
Because we got platinum artists down here that ain't nobody called.
Well, trust me, in a couple of years.
Did you hear what I just said?
Post Malone get the call. No, you hear from that.
Yeah, but still.
But today,
I'm just saying, why is these people not looking at the people, the DeRose and the people who platinum artists? You got them around. But they don't do nothing for these people in New York and Cali.
They not.
They don't respect us. It don't matter if they done it already. They don't get them calls.
You
don't see different people messing around with the people who did have those hits back in the days, you know.
Yep.
Think of some people who really had some good runs back in the day.
I mean, you had Slim Thug.
Slim Thug.
A-Ball MJG.
Chameleon Air, platinum artist.
A-Ball MJG supposed to be getting ready to do one song?
UGK?
We mean Bun B.
You heard what I said?
Yeah,
Bun Platinum B. Artist.
Yeah, Platinum Artist.
Why they on? What's up?
Too dirty for them. That's a dirty, dirty South.
You see what I'm saying?
They want that commercialized dirty South.
But then
South.
We kiss up to these people.
Yeah.
You ask the nigga when they come on the platform, who your best out? Jay-Z. Nigga, get out of here, bro.
They want you
You in the
they
South, want nigga.
And you ass.
That's what I be tripping off of. You here. You done lived it.
Yeah.
Where that recognition, they don't show that same love down here.
No, not at all.
I bet if you gay, they would.
Huh?
I bet if you was gay, they would.
Be
I guarantee if you was gay, they would.
Think about the gay thing about Lil Boosie. Yeah, we better touch on it.
Yeah,
the girl, I'm thinking about 106 and Paul. Breakfast Club, the new 106 and Paul.
Yeah.
Boosie went in on Charlamagne today. Got upset because it was a he she that came on there again.
Yeah.
Somebody from the LGBTQ. And, Basically, they said something about him. So, and he shout out, okay, I see whose side you on. You know, Charlamagne, I'm paraphrasing. What do you think about that?
I feel like if I was Boosie, I'd probably leave that shit alone, dog.
No, you can't. No.
I think I would. You know what I mean? And it's not, but you know what? Because I watched Dave Chappelle's last goddamn Netflix. So I understand exactly where everybody coming from. You know, gay people, y'all niggas always, you know, saying everybody doing us so dirty when black people been taking this treatment for years, goddammit. Like, y'all, you know what I mean? But at the end of the day, if I was Boosie, I think Lil Nas X trolling them kind of a little bit, you know, they got them into the whole spiel and everybody, you know. Yeah, but these days, no publicity is bad publicity, but I think I'd probably try to stay away from that shit. You know what I mean?
Why though?
Because at the end of the day, I don't want that kind of energy around my name, I don't even think.
I understand it, but if you shut Boosie up, then who else you gonna shut up? Somebody got to speak.
Yeah, somebody got to speak. But if I was personally Boosie, I think I'd kind of be
he can't shut up.
But you know what? The thing about it is with Boosie is, see, Boosie could be an intelligent nigga, right? They could sit down and break shit down to us. But Boosie don't know how to articulate that, I feel like.
They don't know. They don't want him to do it.
No, I don't think he can do it.
He can't. They don't want him to do it. Because he be saying valid points. They still trying to flip it around.
Listen, I agree with you.
I heard that nigga say the other day, he said, man, I leave gay people around all my shit. Gay people don't even steal like that.
Right.
And I'm like, man, my nigga know what he want to say. Like, Boosie's smart, but he just can't articulate the shit.
You want to know why? Because it's forming his, like, if he sit down and think about it, he'll do it. But he trying to sit right there and there. I know, because I'm the same way. If I
he
sit
handled
down and think about
real
it,
well on Breakfast Club, though.
If you sit down and think about it, he'll know what he want to say.
It wasn't easy, but he handled himself real well on Breakfast Club. Yeah. Do you think they set him up on Breakfast Club?
Yeah, they most definitely. Come on, man, what them shows about, man. They put a nigga in there. They already had a tranny in there. Right, it was a tranny already there. So, nah, them shows most definitely pull you in there. You know, they gonna get to running that shit. They know Boosie, a nigga gonna speak his mind. He ain't holding his tongue. And that's what Boosie known for.
They get Navy for that.
Yeah, that's what Boosie known
for. That's what they want. They got what they were looking for.
They want Boosie coming there and be full out Boosie, you know, going in and shit. You know what I mean? But salute to Boosie, though. Shout out to Boosie,
man. If he would have came there being quiet, it wouldn't even got that far.
Yeah, yeah. So I guess at the end of the day, when it comes to the Boosie brand, I guess maybe my nigga right here. I guess when it comes to the Boosie brand, you right.
I stand on what you're saying. Like, if you believe in it, don't turn up bad because somebody say something else. Fuck them.
Yeah, that's the way they
feel. Nah, you know what? I'm going to be honest. When it comes to the Boosie brand, that's all he talking about right now. I mean, everybody talking about, you know, I mean, his name stay in every goddamn thing. So when it comes to the brand, that's something Rainwater show you. Rainwater is a master at that. Rainwater.
I was going to ask you about Rainwater, because Rainwater is something else,
Rainwater,
man.
Yeah, Rain.
Shout out to Rain, but so OG Bobby Billions in the Rainwater, you seen him on my show.
Yeah.
What do you think about that? Far as, do you think OG Bobby Billions Blueface version was better than Mo3 version?
Nah. I mean,
let's talk about it.
I understand what OG Bobby Billions was doing. It was like a West Coast version, but Mo3 made that record. You know what I'm talking about? I never heard the song until I heard Mo3 in the kitchen with the chopper singing. But at the same time, OG Bobby Billions made the song. So when you hear the outside part and all that shit, okay, OG Bobby Billions made that. He created that part. That's his song. But when you put Mo3 on it, it makes it a worldwide song. It makes it a song that niggas fuck with.
Now, he made you feel it more.
Yeah, I didn't, I'm gonna be honest, I didn't know the song. I thought it was Mo3 song the whole time. I didn't know who OG Bobby Billions even was. I thought, after I see him in the kitchen with the gun, I go on YouTube looking for the full song. I bump into a nigga named OG Bobby Billions. I'm like, okay, I click on it. Okay, it's his shit, no Mo3. So I didn't know what the fuck was going on. I'm thinking, maybe Mo3 just, you know, liked the nigga's song and redid it. Then people start saying, nah, it's a real, you know, after Mo3 passed away, we start hearing that, nah, it's a real version of that song that's out there. So when the song came out, I think it was dope. But I feel like OG Bobby Billions and Mo3, they both kind of need each other when it comes to how the song came together. That's just common sense. He made the song. He wanted Mo3 on the record. You know, Rainwater said that he was in their inbox trying to get the record, you know, trying to get Mo3 on it. Mo3 heard the record. They said Mo3 liked it. Mo3, did the verse for him. Mo3 dies. Rainwater does the business, though.
No, wait, stop
to get
right
the song
there. I hate to stop.
Mo3 album.
I get it. Now, I agree with that last part, but that's not what OG Bobby Billions told me.
Bobby
Billions told me, and he told Sean Cotton that it was basically his song was played on Say Cheese. Platform and Mo3 hit him up and said he wanted to be on that song. So we got two different different people. And Rain told me the same thing he told you.
Yeah. It's always with Mo3 being gone.
I'm about to try to put them guys together.
Yeah, with Mo3 being gone, it's Rainwater. It's Rainwater word versus OG Bobby being there. Yeah, Mo3 was here, we don't know what Mo3 would say, but it's like it's three niggas involved. One of them passed away, unfortunately, and then you got Rainwater and OG Bobby Billions. Now, Rainwater most definitely, gets under the skin of this nigga and kind of, I think, got this nigga fumbling at his words during his interview.
Oh, man.
Because if Rainwater wasn't saying shit about none of this, OG Bobby Billions wouldn't be responding like that. He wouldn't be saying shit about this and
I
that.
I got a new interview that hadn't come out yet with Rain, man. It's hell.
Oh, yeah, I know. Yeah, he on that nigga ass. I know. He ain't letting the nigga breathe. So, you know, so I think OG Bobby Billions letting Rain trick him into all this shit he doing.
Yeah.
Well, you know, do you think that... Food Stamp Baby?
Yeah, Food Stamp Baby.
How do you like that song?
Yeah, it's an alright record. You know what I mean? But to be honest with you, we're outside. But that's a big
It's hard to
record.
Come behind
yeah,
outside.
Yeah, it's hard to come behind outside. Outside is probably, to me, one of the biggest records we've ever had in Dallas. You know what I mean? Far as these niggas we watch get out the mud. Like you got the Vanilla Ices, Ice Ice Babies, and you got the goddamn Post Malones and all that shit. We talking about these mud records. These young niggas we watch come up. You know what I mean? Get out the mud. You know what I mean? So Outside is most definitely the hardest record. But OG Bobby Billion is going to be hard to come behind that. Then with what's going on between him and the Mo 3 camp, you know, all the Mo 3 fans and all that shit now, is making it really hard on him, bro.
But do you think that he went and, do you think it was something wrong with him going and doing the song with Trap Boy?
Only business-wise. If you ain't got nothing to do with the beef, like he said, I ain't got nothing to do with, I fuck with Mo 3 and Trap, I ain't got no issue with nobody, I can do what I want to do. True that. But OG, he can work with who he want to work with. But at the same time, for business purposes, even Trap Boy said, nigga, that's dumb and a motherfucker. Trap Boy said, nigga, I wouldn't do it. Trap Boy told him, nigga, I wouldn't do it if I was you. Nigga, you crazy. He told Trap, hey, let's do it. So even Trap said, I disagree with him doing a song with me, my nigga. I thought it was business-wise, it was dumb. So if Trap said,
soon, that's what he said.
If Trap even said, then come on, man. OG Bobby Billion probably should have listened. If you're going to listen to anybody at that time, you know, with Mo 3 being gone and you and Rain not seeing eye to eye, whatever, I would have just said, nah, you right. I'll wait. I'll do that song down the line. Let me let this record play out, travel the world, tour the world.
Roll that wave.
Yeah, rolled the wave. Yeah, he fucked up. OG Bobby Billions, I'm here to tell you. You know what I mean? And he probably coming on the show again soon. He been on there once. But yeah, OG Bobby Billions, understand that maybe that wasn't the best move. You know, not at the time.
So do you feel like, what is it going to take to bring Dallas together? I say this every episode. What do you feel?
I feel like time and growth, you know, because this situation is different. I think in Dallas, we always call Dallas a crab bucket, you know, a crab in a barrel city. But this time, it's a lot of lost lives involved now.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of young cats lost their lives. We've seen what happened with Mo 3. And we're not saying that nothing is connected, you know, but we've seen what happened with Yella Beezy, you know, on the tollway. We've seen what happened with Mo 3. We've seen what happened with Roy Lee. Long live Roy Lee. You know, we just got so many brothers that was here yesterday and they gone today. It's just like, I think everybody's kind of sitting back, seeing who's going to make that first move, that first, you know, that first mature move, that first, whether it's an apology, whatever it is, everybody kind of sitting back playing the tough guy role, not wanting to make that first move. So what do we do to make Dallas, you know, I can't even say back, because I feel like we ain't never been, no God, I feel like we ain't never been united. But mm-hmm. I feel like in order to get out of, so basically we was never united, and now shit just crazy. So, I mean, I think we got to get back to the point where we was never united. That's fucked up, ain't it? We got to get back.
It's all these big fishes.
We got to get back to the point where we was never united.
They're talking about the little fishes. The big fishes are always talking about what the little fishes can't do and what they're doing. Like, they not supporting them no way.
You feel like, and when you say big fishes in Dallas right now, when it comes to rappers.
Nope, some of the gatekeepers are in here. They ain't trying to help none of these people. They only doing shit for themselves.
The people on the gatekeeper list? Yeah.
No, it's something that's supposed to be on there. That's not on there. They know what I'm talking about. But they not helping people like they're supposed to. Like, if you really for your city, you're going to help people get on for
Remember,
your city.
Some of these niggas ain't from this city either. Some of these niggas that I think we put on the list ain't even from out here. That's no shots to nobody. You know what I mean?
Say, that's not a shout bad thing, though.
Shout out to the ambassador. You know what I mean? Bay. But at the end of the day, a lot of these niggas ain't from here. They don't know the culture. They wasn't out here from back in the day and shit like that. You know what I mean? They came out here. They got a job. K-104, different shit. And that's how it is, I think, for Dallas. I think a lot of outsiders coming to Dallas and they make moves in Dallas. Niggas right here from the soil just be sitting around looking at shit.
Wow.
You know?
Wow.
So,
no,
yeah.
I think they skip over them. Like, they skip over the people in their own city and they know they got them.
You think so?
Yeah, that's what happened. Man, you got people in your city that can do the same thing outsiders do.
Yeah.
You ain't put no trust into them.
Nah, real shit.
But they didn't even keep the city
What? In. Okay. So, what do you feel like on your show? Do you feel like the most exciting show that you've done thus far? And how long have you been doing this?
I've been doing this for about 11 months now.
Man, you jumped out. Hey, we did the same thing. Yeah. I'm 10 months in the game.
Yeah, December is the anniversary of my Rain World episode.
What you gonna do?
I gotta do something big, man. I don't know, man. I gotta do something big.
You should be proud.
I need to do something big for the 1 year anniversary, man. But on my show, I'm gonna say probably just the back and forth with the other blogger niggas, man. You know, we done set that bitch on fire some nights, nigga. We done brought niggas baby mama on the show. How many people in the chat? Oh, man, I think we done had like 1,700 people in the chat, and that's just on my show. We're not talking about back when I was with another blogger and we had came together and did a show together, and that's back when we had Mo 3, all three of Mo 3 girlfriends up there and all kind of weird, man. Look, man, we had some shit going on. And back then, we was having easily 3,800 people in the chat, 4,000, close to 5,000 people in the chat. Me and that show ended up going our separate ways. He kept doing his show. I started doing my own show. I continue to cover Mo 3, but not all Mo 3. I cover all kind of shit in the black community, trending topics, hip-hop. I bring new artists on there. I try to break new records. So that's what my show is about. My show is about hip-hop and trending topics in the black community. You know what I mean? Man. As well as doing interviews. That's what we talk about over there, man.
Man, I like I said, man, you dope. I love what you're doing, man.
But yeah, we're going to act a fool, though. You know what I mean?
That's fine.
Some nights we might be chilling, and you never a chick might come up, and another chick might come up, and they might just have some disagreements, and her homegirl might join the shit, and a nigga might then 10 of
did
us,
you ever
man,
find
that
out who Maya
off.
Was, man? Who is Maya, man?
Money Maya, man. I think Money Maya.
I
love her name. Yeah, Money Maya. Money Maya is a young lady named Mataya, and she from McKinney, I believe. You know what I'm talking about? And she dated CME DJ and Mo 3 at the same time, I want to say. She had both them niggas' names tatted on her, so my final guess is Mataya for Money Maya.
Hey, man, we finally figured out who she is, man. Rain yeah. says it could be anybody.
Rain gonna keep that bullshit going. I'm gonna let y'all know. I'm going for Mataya is Money Maya, guys.
Hey, man, what's your top three artists of all time, dead or alive?
Dead or alive, man.
Number one. Any genre?
Tupac.
There he is right there.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah, Tupac.
First. Number two.
Ice Cube.
Yeah. Oh, you OG with it.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, I got to go up to the nigga. Number, I was a young nigga.
Number three,
I'm going to go with my dog, Lil Flip. Got
hey,
to.
Gotta
go,
dope,
gotta keep,
man.
Yeah,
got
to go with my dog,
dope,
Lil Flip, man. And you know why I say Lil Flip? Because, you know, Lil Flip was never the most lyrical nigga in the game or shit like that.
I got
that.
Mad when he started trying to be.
But
I didn't like it.
He inspired us niggas in Texas to want to shine and
he
get money.
He showed you that you could shine and get
you
money.
You can do this shit. Lil Flip showed us niggas. You know, I can do that. Lil Flip showed us niggas that he inspired us niggas
fast. Fly with it, too.
Yeah. So
young Lil Flip, really, if he'd have stayed doing what he was doing, he could have easily slid. T.I.
Yeah.
But he started trying to do what he was doing. Yeah. I hate when niggas do that. You tell him I said
game
that.
Sometimes.
You
can't
let
play
that nigga trick
game.
You out of your position, man. Yeah, OG said that. Believe that.
I'm going to get that nigga come up here.
Hey, that's fine.
Y'all need to come sit
down
and chop it up.
You can go down.
Sit down and chop it up.
So,
Take some of his goddamn tea off of goddamn
one. No, that ain't coming off. Because I got me a lot of money, man. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, salute to Raku, man.
Cool. A king of oneself. Follow me and everything. Yeah, and you got to understand the just behind it is, just let me break it down for you a little bit. You know, shout out to my boy, Mike, Ralph. The people really behind the scene who own RP55 Group. These guys have we've done business together since 07. When I didn't have 07, 08, I didn't have an account. You know, those guys gave me opportunity. So when you start dealing with authentic wear, authentic clothes, then your business can stay in a place like this for 15 years.
Yeah.
So when you start looking at it from that aspect, it starts to make sense. You know what I mean?
Yeah, most
because those
now.
Guys really held me down. And you can go on their page, you'll see me on there on the Coup page. I'm always...
And most definitely salute to T.I. Let's be real now.
T.I.
is one of the dopest niggas that ever come through the rap game.
Man,
T.I. is one of them niggas.
The South,
who, that trap music most definitely turned all us niggas up. I remember banging that bitch out. You know what I'm talking about? So salute to T.I. and Lil Flip, man. Two kings. Two legends of the goddamn South, man.
Shout out.
Salute to both of them. Man.
So you think that you feel like everything going to be all right. If you could go back and talk to that younger you. I always ask these questions. You've seen the show. You know it's coming. What would you say to the guy that's about 17, 18 years old about to face what you're about to face at that time? And I always say he wouldn't listen, but still,
man,
what
you
would
know
you
what
say?
I do? I tell that nigga, man, bro, leave these bitches alone, man. Stay away from these gals, nigga. Do nothing, bro. Go get your money. Worry about that later on because my life was always focused on being with a woman. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I was always, just with a, me, shout out to my baby, my BM. we got together when we was young, man. But if I can go back and look at it, salute to my children. You know what I mean? All that. Yeah. But when you go back, you say, you know what? I would have worked harder. I would have finished school. You know what I mean? I would have did everything right before I brought my children to this world. You know what I'm talking about? I would have most definitely got myself more together. You know, got my paper right. You know, made sure my legal issues were straight. Like I said, my daughter was born when I was in jail.
Wow.
You know what I mean? So, yeah. So, if I can go back when I was 17, 18. So, if I can go back in time, fam, I go back and say, bruh, nigga. But you know what I mean? Nigga, put a condom on your dick, nigga. Get back in your books, fam. Graduate high school. You know, find you a little trade or something, my nigga. If you're going to do music, you're serious about it. Record. You know what I mean? Really work, my nigga, and stop playing around. Because I did a lot of time. I spent a lot of time bullshitting around.
What that nigga
said
to you, though? That nigga wouldn't listen, man.
Yeah, anyway,
that nigga looked too crazy.
That nigga went kicking the dough, nigga, while I was talking to him, nigga. Hell no.
Hey, man, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Salute, man.
How can people get a hold of you, man, just on your Instagram?
Yeah, go to the Instagram, man. Follow me, Chris_SKO, or Just Say No to Sko. Go to YouTube, Just Say No, number 2, Sko. Just Say No to Sko. Man, subscribe to the channel, man. Hit the notification bell, man.
You got any more questions for him?
No, I don't. I do.
I knew it. I knew that.
No, ain't no question. Don't let the white boy say nigga no more on your show.
Oh, the white boy. Oh, you know what?
That shit, boy.
Hey, you know what? But let me tell you something. Hey, let me tell you something. I brought him on. That's the type of shit I do.
Yeah.
Because when I brought
him. How did you let him say the N word?
I see why now.
Well, no. Let me tell you.
This thing just came out.
This side went. He was saying the N word in his songs. Like he a rapper that used the N word. It turns out his daddy owned DGs.
Yeah, John.
Man, so I got wind of the whole story. That's why he came on the show. I was like, hold up, his dad working DGs, big country looking ass white boy, saying nigga. I see Negative Sean cover it. I see Negative Sean. I was like, okay, I'm gonna bring him on the show because I know how my crowd is. You know, you come on that bitch tripping, that chat gonna get the hell in your ass. They gonna come up on that motherfucker. So it was him for himself on that motherfucker. When he came, that white boy came, he came in there with two niggas who was saying, nah, this our nigga. Two niggas in the car with him.
They would matter too. Nah, you tripping too. Nah, y'all can't. Hell nah.
You seen it?
No, y'all
he had
tripping,
two
fool.
Niggas in the car with him. And they like, yeah, this our nigga, fat. This our nigga.
We not having that.
Wow. So yeah, I most definitely, but shit like that, I'm bringing that out. That's what my show about. That type of shit that niggas say, nah, I wouldn't do that. I'm doing it. You know what I'm talking about? Because I wanted my chat to see this. We don't get to see this shit unless we do it.
Yeah.
So I already seen what he was doing.
I heard you. Hey, you be crunk over there.
Yeah.
Tell me.
I'm bringing that. Remember that. I'm the Black Geraldo, God damn it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm bringing that shit to the show, fam. Anything when the shit people, if we gotta discuss it and chop it up about it, if niggas think it's right or wrong, what better place to talk about it? Let's bring that shit here.
Let's see. Stand up right quick, man. Let me see that shirt, man.
I've done your show.
Yeah. Fly Caesar, man. You get right here. There you go. Yeah. Just drop down a little bit. Just there you go. Yeah, man. Check that Fly Caesar out, y'all. Y'all got to check him out, man. It's going down, man. That boy there got a hell of an outfit on. Ever since he come through the door, man, that nigga bling, blong, bling. Yeah. You know what I'm talking about?
And the nigga helped me do my merch, too, man. He most definitely did my merch. He taught me the merch game, man. Nigga showed me how to do merch and how, you know, get all my subscribers and everybody get into the merch business, man. So yeah, salute my nigga Stone from Fly Season, man.
Say, man. Hey, man. So how can people get a hold of you?
Yeah, you can
just speak right in that mic right there.
I prefer everybody go to the website, just www.flyseasonapparel.com, and that's apparel, APPAREL, and Instagram at Fly Season Apparel and at StonyC_G-Squad.
That's dope right there, man.
Salute, man.
I need my outfit, nigga. You want me to wear it, nigga? Bring me something through here, nigga.
What's up?
Yeah,
what's
nigga.
Up?
I'm looking. Nigga, I don't know how that stuff run, nigga. I got to see
that.
Right
that nigga a medium, man.
Yeah. Give me a medium, man. Give me a medium, man. Yeah, no, you gonna need a small. That nigga stuff run big.
Yeah,
man. You some little pins on.
What size is that? That shirt?
This extra large right here.
Oh, okay.
Okay, now you might need a large.
Cool. Exactly. Yeah. I'm gonna need a medium.
Come through, man. We'll have a Fly Season day on here, and then, like I said, there's some stuff we can talk about off camera. But there's things that can happen.
Hey,
man.
You wanna know what I met you about?
What's that?
When we supposed to be going to that place in the outfit you got? I mean, I had some shoes at home. I didn't know they matched the outfit. They was white.
Oh yeah,
and you pissed me off because I put that shit on and matched just fine. And I didn't get to go nowhere.
Wow, but you looking good though.
But niggas didn't want to talk about. You see that picture behind you now, right? Now niggas didn't want to talk about. I showed up to the Triple D Revenge movie release, shit on all, including Rainwater owed me $1,000.
Oh,
Rain owed me $1,000. He said it was a fresh.
That nigga
showed up talking about he forgot his pants and shit. He backed in the last man. I said nah, Rain, I need that goddamn band.
Nah, I forgot my pants.
Yeah. Hold on, Rainwater lied, right?
Rainwater lied. He said he forgot his pants. Niggas showed up with some bullshit on. I'm fresh in the motherfucker. Took all the shine on the red carpet. I clowned Mr. E, the director, all the actors in the movie. Nigga, who was all there? Nigga, Mr. Lucci.
Hold on, which movie was this?
This was Triple D Revenge.
Triple D Revenge.
So didn't this man just sit here and say when he went to the one in L.A., right? I mean, not L.A., Atlanta. He said he went to... No, he wasn't. He said in Dallas he was.
Yeah, he said that was at the Royal Lee.
Oh, I just want to
I seen it. He had the Burberry on.
Yeah,
okay,
you're right. Yeah, salute the Rain. He pulled up on Royal Lee shit too. Yeah,
put
up
I
on
he lied. My
yeah,
bad.
He put up on Royal Lee
wrong.
Too, man.
I was wrong.
Yeah, man.
But man, hey man, you guys, man, you dope, brother. I'm so glad you came on the show. I hope we did you justice, man. You always a family member now that you've been on Boss Talk 101.
Come on, man. I'm watching.
You've been rocking with me, man.
I'm watching, nigga. I'm watching, fam.
Yeah, we working.
No, you working, fam.
Every day.
Did this something dope for the city, fam? I feel like, you know, you are that motherfucking Vlad type nigga we need out here.
Man, I'm trying to it, bro. Yeah, you that's a big shooter. But see, I'm different. Like I say, we got you on every angle. We basically said, and we got charisma. You don't see Vlad talking.
Vlad,
you behind the camera. Don't do me like that, man. I'm right here with you, nigga.
Don't do me like that.
I'm right there with you. I love what he's doing. And he way bigger than me. Him and No Jumper.
Hey, but we on the way, nigga. All of us, the DFW, we on the way, man. I'm finna keep acting the fool. I'm finna, I see you doing big things,
bro. Why you think you here, nigga? You acting a damn fool.
For season two, I'm finna do some dumb shit. You know what I mean? I might need you. I got some shit going on.
Let's go.
Hey, look. I'm going on blind dates and shit. I'm doing all kind of shit this year on the show. Now, I'm going in. I'm going all the way in.
Hey, we love you, Chris Cole, man.
Salute, man. Salute to the whole DFW Boss Talk 101.
Check it, man. It's been another great segment of Boss Talk 101.